Here, I want to give you a real basic overview of dance, and we are going to start in Europe where the classical period is. And I want to play this video because it really shows you a contrast in culture, how contrasting the culture was between Europe and Africa, which are the two strongest cultures that influence us in the area of dance. In the area of dance, it started in Italy as a means of controlling how people behave when they they would call that court, CORUT, just like the court, you go to court. But it was originally started as you would go to the court of the king, and you'll see in this video how they explain that. What happens is that it starts in Italy as a means of controlling people and how they behave, how far they would stand from the king, how close they would come to a woman, how they would reach out and touch the woman's hand. It is typical Europe, really. I mean, Europe is a very, very, has been over time, organized culture. And not very spontaneous. It took the Europeans coming here to America and mixing in with our spontaneity, which is a quality of Americans, to take their music, their cultures, their dance, and change it up. So let's take a look at this. It's about 5 minutes, but I think it's a really good overview of the history of what we call ballet, which is the formal dancing method today, but originally it was strictly for rules to control people.
Can you imagine a party where every movement from the slightest gesture to walking across the room and every visual detail from furniture to hemline length were governed by a complex system of rules and procedures? For centuries, such rituals were commonplace for European nobility. And while they've gone out of fashion, we'd recognize the components under a familiar label: ballet. Ballet, from Italian balletto or little dance, originated in Renaissance Italy as a combination of social dance and choreographed display at aristocratic gatherings. In many aspects, it was a way of controlling people in court with acceptable forms of behavior, such as the manner in which people stepped, bowed, or took someone's hand.
To start our section in ballet, which is a very important concept of dance, right? I want to start off with this little video to explain to you how different and show you how dramatically different the European culture is from the African culture. Europe and Africa are the most significant impactors on our culture in America, which is why I focus on them now as we go forward. If you talk about Chinese have dance, all cultures have dance, but certainly the two cultures that have really impacted our culture is Europe and Africa for obvious reasons that we've already talked about. But what you want to know is that ballet, which is dance, today it's a dance theater. In other words, it's a show, it's a concept, and we'll look at some of that. But in the beginning, ballet started in Italy as a means of controlling how people behaved and moved in the presence of the king. You had to be so many steps away from the king. There was a certain way to reach out with your right arm and shake a man's hand, or how to step out with your left foot and then maybe bow to a female, and all these rules. Kings felt they had to control everything, including how people acted physically. So you have to realize it starts in Europe, in Italy. It then moves to the rule thing moves to France, but France turns it into a show, basically, through the efforts of a king called Louis the 14th. You may have heard of that name, and that's when it starts to turn into an art form. Now, people that study dance, I don't care if they're in Broadway today or they're whatever they're doing, unless they're really doing like a whole break dance thing, which has happened on Broadway, all study ballet. When they study dancing, they start with ballet. Because what ballet does do is does teach you to keep your body centered, control everything, and then, but if you have that basic training, you can go from there. But here's a great video, it's not too long, about less than 5 minutes, shows you the history of the European dance, which is the most significant one to come out of Europe, is ballet and its methodology. It starts in Italy and it moves to France. And France, that's why the French ballet is really the main thing that influences our culture and all ballet going forward.
Can you imagine a party where every movement from the slightest gesture to walking across the room and every visual detail from furniture to hemline length were governed by a complex system of rules and procedures? For centuries, such rituals were commonplace for European nobility, and while they've gone out of fashion, we'd recognize the components under a familiar label: ballet. Ballet, from Italian balletto, or little dance, originated in Renaissance Italy as a combination of social dance and choreographed display at aristocratic gatherings. In many aspects, it was a way of controlling people in court with acceptable forms of behavior, such as the manner in which people stepped, bowed, or took someone's hand. It also involved rules governing everything from attire to where one could walk or sit in relation to the king. Over time, the study of ballet became a central element of court life, and proper grasp of the etiquette could make or break one's success as a courtier. Many of these court gestures can still be seen in modern ballet techniques. Ballet was brought to France in the 16th century by Catherine de' Medici, the Italian wife of King Henry II. As celebrations became more lavish, so did the dance, with dancing masters teaching elaborate steps to young nobles, and story elements providing a unifying theme. The focus shifted from participation to performance, and the form acquired more theatrical trappings, such as professionally designed sets and a slightly raised platform or stage with curtains and wings. But it was in the 17th century court of Louis XIV that ballet was refined into the art we know today. Louis himself had been trained in ballet from childhood. His early role as the sun god Apollo at age 15 cemented the central role ballet would play during his reign. It also earned him the title of Sun King, with his splendid golden costume and choreography that promoted the idea of the king as a divinely ordained ruler. Louis would go on to perform 80 roles in 40 major ballets, either as a majestic lead or sometimes playing minor or comedic parts before emerging in the lead role at the end. He trained daily in ballet as well as fencing and riding, and through his example, dancing became an essential skill for all gentlemen of the era. But Louis XIV's main contribution to ballet was not as a performer. His founding of the Royal Academy of Dance in 1661 shifted control of ballet from local guilds to the royal court. As director, he appointed his personal ballet master and frequent performance partner, Pierre Beauchamp, who codified the five main positions of the body still used today. Through his collaborations with Jean-Baptiste Illouis, the director of the Royal Music Academy, and famed playwright Molière, Beauchamp helped establish ballet as a grand spectacle, and in 1669, a separate ballet academy was founded. The Paris Opera Ballet survives today as the oldest ballet company in the world. Ballet moved away from the royal court to the theater and survived the democratic revolutions and reforms that followed over the next century. With the advent of the Romantic movement, fantasy and folklore themes became common motifs. And though the influence of ballet in France would decline, other countries such as Russia would play a major role in its further development.
Now I want to pause here because, interesting, he talked about the revolution. The French Revolution, of course, is a revolt against the kings. The American Revolution is a revolt against the British government. What you have to understand is that you'll notice that the ballet started in Italy, and then it moved to France. And the reason it moved to France is because the Italian queen, married the French king of the time. And so one thing I want to tell you is that if you hear about a king of a country, let's say king of Austria, he might not be Austrian at all. He could be French. For example, the Tsar in Russia was the cousin of the king of England when the two countries fought in World War I prior to the takeover of the communists. The royalty of Europe is not bound by borders. Basically, it was the upper class rich landholders who would go and serve as king, become king of a country through some power, move of some sort. But there's a couple of families that kind of controlled all of Europe, which is kind of interesting. But they mentioned how the themes of ballet changed from going from entertaining and performing for kings and queens to the theater outside of royalty, which is the same thing, right, that happened with Mozart and Beethoven and the others on the musical side. So what I'm trying to tell you is all the arts move away from this control factor. In the beginning, the aristocrats, those are people with money and control and royalty, they had the money to support the arts, right? The arts eventually break away from them. You'll see a similar story when we mention a little bit in America how that changed, where the record companies controlled all the artists in the 50s and 60s, and how certain people broke out and broke that mold, and the musicians started to control it. This theme is very common in the arts. Let's f finish this up. That's something I want to make sure that you picked up. And notice they mention Russia as the French Revolution occurs and the people are taken over. In fact, they took the queen and they put her to the guillotine and killed her. If you know your French history, I mean, they were like killing people. Same with Russia eventually with the communist government. But Russia picked up the ball where France left off. The three countries involved in ballet heavily, you should know about: the Italians for starting it, the French for really making it an entertaining mode, and the Russians for expanding to huge productions. That's where like Nutcracker Suite and stuff comes out, all that. Tchaikovsky's a big writer.
Fortunately, today most of us don't have to learn a complicated set of steps just to socialize at a wedding. Instead, we can go to the theater to see professionals who spend their lives training rigorously to perform feats that would have been unimaginable in Louis XIV's day.
All right, let's pause a second. I'm going to show you another. Now we have a whole different thing. Remember, I told you the Africans never had a name for dance. They didn't have a name for any of the, or for music for that matter, a word for describing it. Because remember, the African artistic culture is a collective of the village, of the community, where all forms of expression happen at the same time. It's so obvious the difference between the two cultures, right? And the African slaves who came into the Americas, both North and South, had to bust through eventually the formal culture that was in the South, certainly on the plantations and places like that. And eventually it comes true. And I think it's so interesting because there's a lot more variety, it appears, in this particular production, because it's not just dance. It's singing, it's dance, it's a storyline, it's instruments being played at the same time. The musicians are dancing. Take a look at this. It's about 6 minutes. It's really fun to watch, and it shows you how different the two cultures are from their base. Think about how ballet started, that I just showed you, and now how African dance starts. I love how you watch the men. They have so much control of their body center that even when they jump and they dance, the body itself, the torso, is very still. It's not jiggle around. That is also true in ballet if you're good at it. But these guys are good at their dance. The other interesting thing is this music has 6 beats in a menu or a bar. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That's why it sounds different to you. It's not 4-4. It's not 4 beats for a menu like this. See how still their body is? So this would be kind of a typical dance that's been going on for centuries. It is folk dance, right? But it has a story to it, and they've made a little video about it, which is really pretty cool. And let's see where this can go. I want to show you a really elaborate, more elaborate production by some young people today in Africa and how they've taken it, as I said, and really elaborated on the whole concept of community art, community performance of all forms in Africa. Only comes in it. Okay, we're ready to rock now. This is obviously a more modern time, but look at how they have pulled forward the roots of their culture, so different from what we have in the European side. I hate to pause it, but do you see all the theater? There's a huge story going on here. This is a blending. And think about going to Hamilton or going to any theater in America. You would not have all of that stuff going on unless you had the influence of the African spontaneity of the community, of the culture. And in Europe, it brings the formality of Europe, the big stages and all of that, and put the orchestra in front and do a whole musical. But this is the roots of our culture in America, and it's so different than the rest of the world. Here we go. Now the traditional African dance is very, very authentic. A lot of curling motion to the arm, head, facial gesture. I mean, that turn. Look at how they turn, and they all stand at the right time. Very artistic. I think the fellas get around with the drums at some point. Maybe not. There's a couple of videos of this. But I think it's interesting because these are young people in Africa today, and they're continuing their heritage. I'm going to pause and show you a contrasting. And so how were the Europeans dancing after they got rid of the king? I mean, it was still had all that structure to it. Here's a 1700 minuet dance of Handel's music. But look at the difference right here. Here's Europe after we just saw Africa. So everything's kind of ballet-ish. You see how they have these gestures? But this is like jamming for these people back then, okay? This is like really reaching out. Well, this would have been before Mozart's time. Now we got the do-si-do, right? This is carried out in America later on. Walking around and grabbing at a lady's hand. All right, you can see, sorry for the break. You can see the obvious difference between the two cultures. When you blend them together, you get the best of both worlds, however. So in fact, this classical music you're hearing, a lot of classical music, not so much in Mozart's time, but before him, was designed for dance. And so we see this relationship between the two. All right, let's check it out. Ah, whole different culture. This is Scot-Irish. This, in this case, it's Ireland. Remember, Ireland and Scotland, or Ireland, are pulled away from Europe. They're an island by themselves. This has a huge impact. The dancing style of the Irish has a huge impact in culture. Let's watch some of it. This is actually, I think it's in Dublin, or maybe it's not. Galway. Whole different deal. Remember the fast-talking Irish we showed earlier on the other tape? Here we go. Now that instrument is a little concertina, they call it sometimes a squeeze box. The way it works is there's a bevel in here. That means a sealed area where the air goes in, and he squeezes it out, and it makes the air come out of these little buttons when he presses them. And that's a real common instrument all over Europe. It shows up in different cultures as well. But notice in this case, a single performer dancer emulating the fast doodly 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 notes of the Irish. Different purpose, different than England and France, where they got all the formal gowns on. Music, dancing of the common people, but not a community celebration like the African was. You see the difference is everyone gets involved in Africa. Here is a more of a performance deal, but a very different type of dance. She wears clicks on her shoes, right? And that's what imitates a drum kind of sound with the feet. And some of this can get very, very elaborate if you're familiar with some of the professional performers throughout the United States today do the Irish dancing. In fact, there's a lot in Chicago. Let's see where this goes in America. What kind of dance evolves here? You remember me telling you about how the Scotch-Irish all went to the Appalachian Mountains, down to hillbilly country? Living in the mountains, one little house stuck up in the mountains here. There are towns in the South, Nashville and all that, but in the beginning, there were no towns. The Scot-Irish wanted to be left alone. They were very good warriors, by the way, and they fought their way into the mountains down there and fought with the Indians, but then they built their houses, and they really wanted to be left alone, and they would live far apart from each other. That dancing we just saw in England, here's how it evolves in America. It's called clogging, see? Bluegrass clog dancing. We'll explain what bluegrass is later. But look at the similarity, but they put a little more twist. They take some of the partner dancing that the Europeans were doing with the street foot dancing, and you get this. This is probably back in the early 60s.
I'll dance this way.
These are young kids. You hear their feet stomping. This is just in somebody's living room. So you remember when the royalty people we showed you two videos back, or a couple of videos, they were like holding hands with their partner, and then they would change partners, let go of the hand of their other partner. Here everyone's holding hands, boy, girl, boy, girl, boy, girl, and then they combine with the feet, with the dancing part, with their feet at the bottom, right? There it is. It's called Do-Si-Do. And so this is kind of a performance because there's people watching, but it's really just a party for dance and has some elements of that. But think about these three cultures, right, coming to America, ready to collide and create a brand new musical culture. But where does tap dance come from? You saw the Irish stomping around, and you saw a little bit of that from the African culture. But when you blend those two together a little bit and you change the rhythm, you know, you think about those kids dancing in the living room. It was like doom daga doom daga doom daga doom daga doom daga, the same thing over and over again. But if you put some jazz to it, decades later, you see that the idea of using your feet as a drum substitute actually comes from the slave era, because they were not allowed to play drums, slaves, when they came, because their masters feared that would be signaling other slave groupings to come together and overthrow the master. So they would put sand on a wooden floor, and they would use that as a drum. And they had to have the drum, right? The drum is so like part of everything they do musically in Africa. So they substitute tap. Now this is many decades later, but tap becomes an art form unto himself. This is Bill Robinson. He's called Mr. Bojangles in character, but see what he does with the rhythm of his feet.
Mr. Bill Green and his famous tap dance.
In this movie, they call him Bill Green, but it's really Bojangles. Hear the jazz rhythm? But now, the feet are primary and the dancing secondary, right? The arms are there and the face is there, but it's all about the feet as a musical instrument. Okay, that's what we got here. And it shows you a lot of great things about you. And we'll sing now. This guy, Bill Robbins, is considered the founder and the master of tap in America. And this is an American art form here, okay? This is invented in our country. So clear too, right? Those are white men in black face. We'll talk about that when we get to the blood and the racial implications of that. Alright. Now I'll show you the best there ever was. In a second. There is no one that can equal, in my mind, the artistry of dance and tap, really tapping and dancing, as the Nicholas Brothers. The Nicholas Brothers grew up in the music business. This is a film, a very famous film, that shows you how athletic they were and how they took it to a whole nother level. And then I'm going to take a look at Fred Astaire, who would be the white version and considered the best, you know, Caucasian dancer. And his got a little more smoothness to it, different kind of style, but these are the dance styles that grew up in America, and then you see how they blended in with the Irish, with the European, and with the African culture. Here's the Nicholas Brothers. Enjoy this. Now, I just want to tell you a whole quick story because I want to turn the volume up. That guy right there, he's a leader. His name is Cab Calloway, and he's a big-time jazz guy. I'm going to turn him up a little bit. And he's from Chicago. And since my father grew up in Chicago on the South Side, he did meet Cab Calloway once. But my father was only about 6 years old, and his older brother, James, they run into this man in a very smartly dressed suit. And my father and his brother were walking up the alley off Wentworth Avenue, which is right just west of the Dan Ryan, picking up pop bottles for money during the Depression. And here come this man with the suit on, and it was Cab Calloway, and he flipped my father a nickel. So I always felt connected to Cab Calloway. This is his big band. The Nicholas Brothers will be out a little bit, and I've turned the volume up, so maybe you adjust yours if you need to.
Oh boy, what you gonna say to that kid? Alamar, Shalimar, Swanee Shore. Let me dig this jab once more, oh boy.
Right on down to jail.
Oh boy,
gotta dig fine and
now kids, you hear those hep cats call. Come on boys, let's have a ball. The jim jam jump with the jumping jive makes you dig your jive on the mellow side.
This is swing music from the 30s in America. We'll chat about it at the end of the course, but we spend more time, of course, in the American course I teach. But here we go. They're going to be out soon.
Jim Jam Jump is a solid shot. Makes you 9 foot tall when you're 4 foot five. Hip, hip. Hip, hip. Now don't you be that ickle-roo. Get hip, come on, and then you follow through. You get your study full. You make up the jolly jump and like the gators do. Jim Jam Jump is a jumping shot. Makes you like your eggs on the jersey.
Why do I show this guy? This is my little secret. Did you hear what he just did? This man is considered one of the first men besides Louis Armstrong to actually, what they would call today, rap in a song. Now, they rap with real words today. Sometimes they don't. But the idea of a vocalist, a singer, just mouthing some sounds in a rhythmic pattern like that, although he does sing it, that is introduced by Louis Armstrong, Cab Calloway. This was going on a ways back. So when we talk about rap at the end, you'll see there's a connection there too. A lot of history. Dig it, right? So there's the Nicholas Brothers. One's a little older than the other, but they always were a dual act. And you heard them doing what? Call, response, right? Cab Calloway would go, and the Nicholas Brothers, they're imitating each other. They're doing call, response. This is what I want you to recognize. Now let's watch them dance to the end. They're just out of this world. Call response, folks. Is that nuts or what? I mean, you just don't see that. Those guys, man. Look at how explosive this culture is in America, and how, you know, you take some basic cultural facts in other countries, you put people into one place, and this is what happened. This is a story of our history, of course, in music and everything. All right, give me a sec. Well, Fred Astaire is considered the strongest Anglo dancer of his day, sets a whole lot of styles. He's studied by all the dancers. Any dancer in the world, no matter what their background, race, they study all these guys, okay? Michael, for example, Michael Jackson, of course, he knew the Nicholas Brothers inside and out, okay? He knew Fred Astaire inside and out. They study the other artists that are maximized. So here, you know, you can see the toned down version a little bit different, but look what Fred Astaire does with his act here involving some drums.
Come on, you Totney Wildcats. Give. Thank you.
he goes on to play a whole bunch of drum stuff there, but I just want to show you the differences. And so, you know, in my American music class, we go in a little more depth in the history of dance through the jazz eras and what have you. So, and I got one more. You're probably getting tired of dancing, but this is really covering a whole big unit for you. And you might ask, what do I need to know? Know these key people, who they are. And I believe this one here will show you some of the style differences. About 3.5 minutes, and you'll recognize some, but I'm sure. This would be, you know, from the modern era of the 20th century, starting with the jazz era primarily. All right, what do we got here? All right, here we go, guys. Thanks for watching. Here you see a break, right? I mean, break dancing starts to kick in. This is what changes, a fundamental style change here. Even the 50s during Elvis's time was a carryover from the 40s and 30s. But here we see a different, much more different things.
Recital. I think it's very vital to rock
around.
That's right,
on top.
It's tricky. It's so tight.
Here we go.
It's tricky to rock around. That's right, on time. It's tricky. It's tricky.
Stop. Break it down.
Soulja Boy, tell
me. Soulja Boy, I'm in it. Oh. Why me crank it? Why me roll? Why me crank that Soulja Boy? That Superman? That oh. Now why me?
Teach me, teach me how to duck, duck. Teach me how to duck. Teach me, teach me how to duck.
You're a jerk. You're a jerk.
Now walk it, now walk it, now walk it, now walk it, now walk it.
Twerk it, 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 twerk it.
Watch me, nana.
Okay.
Now watch me, whip. Watch me, nana.
Why me do it?
Watch me.
Oh!
Do you see why it's important to talk about dance and music in this class? Because, you know, the dance brings out the music, does it not? It helps you interpret it, regardless of the words. You know, it's the sound. And so that's what's really helpful, I think, to see the different cultures first from the old country leading to where we're at right now. I hope you enjoyed that. It's always one of my favorite things to look at, connection between dance and music.